Hello, so today I thought about doing a past life tarot recall reading. Normally I would do this in like sections, meaning I would like let you pick a card, but for whatever reason, this specifically stood out, so maybe at a later date. But I've really been feeling the whole K2. So I have some selenite pieces, I have some K2, and I have this Lemurian crystal. So guides, please come forward. My guides, may you speak nothing but the truth. Truth is, let's talk about past lives. Now, a lot of times people, when you have like past life lineages that are coming through, a lot of times it could be the intuition coming through. But I also want to say it's also sometimes it's like ancestral past lives. So it necessarily may not be just you if you're open to it. So some of you could have been a groundskeeper for a lord in the medieval times. You could have been an artist, a great artist, and I'm getting specifically in Italy during the Renaissance. One of you specifically, if you haven't had this, was a groundskeeper or a gardener or a landscaper for the royal family in France during the 1400s under Louis XIV or Louis XV. Either Louis XIV or his grandsons. But the Justice card, this kind of made me think that maybe you were on the ends of the spectrum, I guess, of, you know, your lord's brutality. That's what I'm hearing, unjustly, that you spoke out against something that you had seen on the ground or you had seen on a hunting trip. And so this was keeping hush hush because they knew that it would be stripped. They would basically have something happen to them. And in return, this imbalance, I guess, with justice, you know, that it was taken out on you. But at the same time, it's like you were provided for. This unjustly act at the hands of this lord, what is going on here for this past life for this person? So we have the Page of Wands, an unjustly act. So you saw something this lord had done, or the lord of this manor, or something in the household that you saw done to, I'm getting, to a servant, and you spoke up about it. And so this like witch hunt, for whatever reason, was placed on you, and you know, your family was taken care of after this. You know, it was just, it was hush hush. So like the lady of the manor was actually took very like polite sympathy for you to speak up for this, and using this, she rewarded your family for your action and your decision to speak up, because that freed her up and freed them up from the misdoings of the lord of the manor. She loved your family, but specifically this woman who was elderly, really took sympathy on a child in this, or maybe you were that child, so therefore that sympathy had, you know, turned to your family. So there was an expansion. I am really seeing that she freed your family, if that makes any sense. So there was a bit of serfdom for this life. So when she freed that up, or freed your family, they were given new opportunities. And so they were actually, since the husband was put, you know, for his misdoings, he was actually disowned from the family, and wealth just basically went to the wife so she could distribute with her children and your family. I really do get the sense of this woman really, like, treated you like your family were her own family, if that makes any sense. So I do get, like, a strong sense of, like, familiar bond, if that makes any sense. So this page of cups, you know, is like shaky ground, but it's also finding your footing. So in a sense, your family was given the choice to stay on the property, and they could have a bit of the property themselves, or they could venture off and do what was necessary for them. And so some of them did. It was like a divide. So some of them ventured out, and some of them actually established themselves. What, this establishment, what is it? Because I'm seeing business, like a tanning business or landscaping. They walked away. Some of them walked away to establish a business of themselves, and some of them actually... I'm hearing blacksmith in that card, specifically with the Five of Swords. I'm hearing a blacksmith. So some of them were actually taking skills that they had learned, you know, through the hard work that they were doing, you know, for the Lord and the, you know, the lady of the manor. They were actually venturing out, and they actually established a business for themselves and making their own money. So yeah, there was balance, and there was like a give back, but at the same time, it was kind of shaky. For, you know, your offspring, that they were learning, but at the same time they were still being benefited by the lady of the manor, being the fact that a lot of the business came from their business, I guess. So there was still work done. They were just paid handsomely in return. So yeah, they some of them kind of felt like trapped, like they had nowhere to go. But a lot of it is the fact that they saw opportunity to work with these individuals. So yeah, this opportunity presented itself, and there was actually jumping forward 3 generations, this 3rd generation that... This 3rd generation, why am I being fast forward to this generation? So they've recovered, you know what I mean? Business was good. Business expanded. They had, you know, venturing, and I'm seeing that they actually went to a port town, and they were actually quite successful. And in that, actually, they worked for the King of England. That this generation actually worked for the King of England, supplying their horses with shoes and their metallurgy means. This Queen of Swords, with this generation, this mistress, whose mistress is this? So, there is, with one of these generations, caught the eye of one of the nobility of England. The very close confidants of the king, and she ended up great-great-grandchild ended up becoming his mistress and eventually the mother of his son, his successor. Even though he was a bastard, he was still given full honor of the family, if that makes any sense. So in return, there was another give back, basically rising from serfdom and slavery to the high echelons. You know, they made it, you know what I mean? They made it. But there is hardships even in that. And so there was an intense affair. And I'm seeing that this mistress ended up having an affair with the king's son. Okay, but now, and it was found out. It was found out and it was ridiculed. And so this got her disowned from the husband that eventually married her. This disownment, did it go into the sun? What happened to her? What happened? So I'm hearing worked to death. Why am I hearing worked to death? What happened? So the husband was out, I'm hearing crusade, and so off to battle, and basically they fell in hard times, and so using her abilities, she basically worked that to basically bring in a new cycle. And so while he was away, news struck, and basically they lost. And so coming from basically nothing and basically being self-made, she basically made something out of nothing, if that makes any sense. She was given opportunity and she took it. So yeah, I'm really hearing that. So yeah, she spared no expense, if that was the case, to make sure that her child was taken care of. So this working to death, like what caused this? So the jealousy of the husband, basically as punishment, he basically took her and basically made her a serf, is what I'm saying. So she may have died in destitution because of this decision. It was unfortunate, it was unseen, but it was there. However, I do feel like even after she died, this lover that she loved so much, you know, he spent the rest of his life mourning for her. So, and he was with other people, but there's just something about this past life that makes me think that there was a love triangle. He knew he was in it, and he knew that because of him being closest to the king, he was untouchable. But he did continue to work. He did have this completion because they did have a child. So this child was taken care of. And from what I'm seeing, this child grew up in a court system in the 1300s. 1400s. The later years. So this child basically wanted for nothing. And so he was actually bestowed a family title and basically the king's adopted nephew. So he basically, you know, had the riches, but yet he still looked out for the underdogs. And I'm seeing that 4 generations later, you know, they were still giving back to people and freeing them as advocates, you know, to basically end serfdom in these countries and just like that. But yes, it's the mother's love that basically kind of had that reputation of even in death, they still wanted to be reunited. And so I guess, like, what a mother does for her children is given, but they did rise above everything. And so that is a past life for some of you, maybe one of you, I don't know. This is what I get. So I'm really getting England and France. I mean, that's still geographically like a huge like land, you know, with the English Channel and everything. But yes, yeah, so it's one past life that I'm getting. I'm still hearing chatter. It's very indecisive, but nonetheless, it's still chatter. And so some of you are being really called to connect into this, like one individual specifically is being asked to connect back with this lineage that has resonated with you. It's weird, but thank you so much for this. And I mean, there's going to be multiple different past life readings that I can make into this video. And another thing that I wanted to talk about, what this past life that came through. All right, what is the second past life? What is a second past life? For someone watching this video in any time, space, continuum, what is a second past life that has to be touched in? What is this lineage? So I'm getting Roman, a priestess, a Vestal Virgin. Is this priestess a Vestal Virgin? Okay. So we have a priestess and we have Artemis. Okay. So we have a priestess at Artemis. An initiate of Apollo. Yep, that alone, she is an initiate of one of the mystery schools of Greece or Italy at the time. And these initiates, obviously, they come from money. They come from prestige. So in this initiate basically had to leave the comfort to basically be initiated in to the priestly class, I guess, with this ritual sacrifice. And basically, she became what they call the mother of priestesses, meaning she's like the priest mother, if that makes any sense. So I'm getting sacred prostitute of Apollo. This sacred prostitute of Apollo, like, what? Can you clarify this? Because this makes no sense. Where are we? We're in Greece, an island of Greece. Where is this? Is this card where she's from? From a chieftain class? What is the year? So I'm hearing 182 BC. So matters are illuminating, they're coming up. In darkness, there was light, there was war, there was warring between three nations of, you know, Grecian peoples. Can you tell me exactly which peoples we are talking about, which country or what city-state of Greece we are talking about? So then we have this. So this tells me that she was a daughter and basically sent to become a priestess. It wasn't her first choice. She actually loved a chieftain since they were children, and basically the father sent her away to keep peace because of the fact that if he would have married her off, it would have actually caused a bigger war. So I'm hearing Sparta. Okay, so who are the other two parties in this? The Cretans, a sect of people that lived on Crete, where she was sent to be because it was neutral. And this wasn't her choice. I feel like she really did try to run. She, in a sense, this home. But yeah, she was guided and she was initiated. I'm hearing the preserver of life. Well, we have Oracle of Delphi right here. The seer. So this seer, did she end up becoming this initiate of Apollo? Or did she actually become the oracle itself? Like, what is going on here? Nope, she became a seer, Apollo seer. I'm hearing one of three. One that had an ancient tie, lineage, bloodline to the earth, to the Titans. To the children of the moon, but to the sun. Mother of the sun? She who stands alone. Mother of all. The mother of all. Is she supposedly prophesied to be the divine host, were Apollo's mistress? Bigger picture at play. The seer who knows all. The seer who's gone to creation. The seer. The seer whom Apollo delights. His incarnated self. His divine self. The holiest place. The mother. The ancient one. whom he returns. Gifts, bestone creativity, bestone birth, restone, form, restored. She who is protected by the beloved, watched over, gifted. Tortured. Ceremonial union. Unprovoked. Willingly. Okay, cards, what insights do you have for me? So, union, love, divine love, emotions, passion, blazing, coming from golden chariots, no other suitors, so this oracle, the gods love, yes, his human counterpart. This initiate, can you actually clear up some of the messages that were given? So basically this seer, this sacred, which is like the gods' prostitute, not like temple where she would sleep with, you know, revenants or anyone who came into the temple to pay their respect to the gods or to come through. She was one of the seers. But there was swift punishment to anybody who touched her because of the fact that she was one of three who were able to see this specific entity or this specific god. So basically, only these three people were basically his human, I guess, concubines, I guess. Sacred concubines. And so they had the ability to communicate with him, and yet he only delighted to talk to them specifically. So these three souls that were coming in through basically channeled them. So in a sense, they were kind of like the three generations of women who could talk to them. So therefore they were kind of like the high priestesses or the high seers. And they therefore were in charge of communicating, you know, between worlds. And so these women were basically encouraged to because of the weird, they actually were encouraged to be basically like sister wives, to split the duties of the sacred duties of having intercourse or sacred intercourse, or, you know, intercourse by proxy, with this entity, this god, with Apollo. And so with the one that I channeled specifically, she was more to the point where she kept the channel open and she was actually the strongest. So therefore she communicated with, you know, them for most of her thing. So there was gifts bestowed by this And so something that she struggled with, because it was like torture, you know what I mean? This animalistic thing to come out, there was something that she saw that was just so off-putting that I'm hearing gouge your eyes out. She saw things that were just, they didn't make sense. But this gift was bestowed by this flame. And I'm saying these are the three women. So there was union, you know what I mean? There was a deep love, but it was something that was, it was so off-putting that it made her want to walk away. It left her with anxiety, and it kind of felt like it was a burden to see all these things, knowing the fact that whatever she saw, it would leave like a physical like indent or imprint on her. So she did actually try to walk away from the temple and leave, but there was just something that always kept pulling her back. No matter how well she hid herself, there was just something that would always get her sent back. And so she basically was saying until she can complete her service, she would never be able, but she felt imprisoned by this entity, this fate. And so as much as she tried to help people, she always felt like something would take from her. And so there were shortcuts. And even though she was bestowed this great honor, this great cycle, it was always like, no matter what she did, there was just something that was always going to haunt her. And until the day she could be set free, you know, she... Why am I seeing a chiseled, you know, piece of bone? Why am I seeing a chiseled piece of bone? Illuminating matters, illuminating fights, illuminating demons, illuminating what it really was, taking matters into own hands. Conflict, shortcuts, working on a master plan. Okay. So basically the matters that she took was to basically disinherit these gifts or disinherit this spirit. So there was like an exercise that she had to do because she knew that for whatever reason there was something more at play. And intuition was actually just constantly telling her all these things that she had to get away or she had to do things. And so, you know, these emotions that haunted her for so long, these women, they just weren't right. They were just crazy, you know? And so there was just things about this entity that would just possess. So like it was all in her head. So it's like leaving an establishment means that she would have to leave everything behind. She basically expanded to get away, and, you know, delay after delay, people were watching. She just always felt like she was fighting, or she just felt imprisoned, or just like nothing was ever right. And so when I saw the chisel to the head, basically a lobotomy. So yeah, she lobotomized herself to basically get rid of the pressure, get rid of this, and basically she ended up dying. How did she die from this lobotomy? Transition? What is this transition? I'm saying Apollo took her home, and there she's always been. That was confusing for some of them, so I have no clue what's going on. That was weird, but thank you, Spirit, for coming through. I hope that this was entertaining just as much as it was confusing for me. So I wish you utmost peace, love, and happiness. If you have any suggestions of past lives that, you know, you would like to be touched on culturally wise, let me know. Or if you guys have any suggestions of topics that we can talk on, expand, grow, whatever, then I would be happy to do some research and make a video. So hope you guys have a fantastic week, and I hope you have a good day.